Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Oh my gosh, that was so good. I don't even have to ask you to do it again. This is great. My name is Pastor Cassie. I am so happy to be here with you today. And before we dive into worship together, I do have a few announcements for you. Firstly, we are so honored to have Pastor Bob preaching and giving us the word today. So I'm just so thankful for you and for the partnership that we have started in ministry together. So thank you for preaching today. We do have a few announcements. We have a Coffee with Pastor Cassie coming up this Thursday, 18th, at Simple Coffee. For those that can make it, awesome. We had about 9 people last week. It was fantastic. We had a, or 2 weeks ago. It was fantastic. We had a great time. And so next we have a few other things. Bible study with the one and only Pastor Bob. It started up last week. There was, 13 people there last week. So we're just, that's the first one of the season. So we're off to a great start in all of the things. Okay, so this is the big one. When I arrived here, I was shown this logo. The next one. And no one knows where it came from. And I was like, well, if no one knows where it came from, maybe we should come up with our own logo. And so we are going to do a logo collab, right? That's a very fancy, hip term for collaboration. And so we, what is going to happen is you can either email me your idea of what you believe our logo as PPC should be. If you're not tech savvy, that's fine. We have a form in the back that you can fill out. You can hand it to me. You can hand it to, an elder, and they'll hand it to me. Or you could bring it into the office and hang out with the Karen and say hi. So we have lots of options on how to participate. And what will happen is on the 11th, once we've collected all of your submissions, Rebecca and I, our communications director, will take all of that information and create a couple of different options, and then we'll get to vote on which one we believe represents PPC the best. Voting is very Presbyterian, so we're right in line with everything that we do here. So I really hope that you will submit your understanding. One of my favorite phrases that on our website and a part of our mission is that we are the heart, hands, and feet of God, right? The heart, hands, and the feet. I love that there's the heart part of it. So take some time, consider who we've been and where we want and who we want to be. That's a lot of what we've been doing already of who we are as a community. So I hope that we'll have all the submissions, and it's going to take, be really difficult for me and Rebecca. That's the goal. Make it as difficult as possible for Rebecca and I. Okay, so also, this is big news. I have to get installed. Did you know that? I should do that. So on September 18th at 2 p.m. in this very sanctuary, that's also a Sunday, there will be an additional service. The reason it's in Sunday afternoon is because within our denomination, multiple pastors have to be involved, and they have their own Sunday service that they have to do. So, and one of my dear friends will be coming down, Reverend Maggie, from LA to participate as well. So she and I went to seminary together, and so it's just going to be a lot of fun. And I really hope that you all will join us. It's a big family deal, so it should be a good time. Also, we're still doing this whole COVID thing. I appreciate, you all doing what is best for you. I will be navigating this guy as you per usual. If you forgot a mask, that's totally fine. We have some in the back for you as you enter in on that little table. So no worries. We are all in this together, and we're all figuring it out. But please be intentional. And when the community question comes around, please feel comfortable just, if you don't want to talk to anybody, you feel like you want to stay in your own little bubble, no stress. We're on your team. We're all doing this together. So I think we did it. We did it. Okay, that was a lot. Before we have our call to worship, pray with me, please. Divine One, Creator God, you are so good. You are good in the times when we can't see good. You are good in the times when everything seems to be good. Help us, Lord, no matter where we are today, to see your goodness. Help us to feel in your Holy Spirit's presence here with us. And we ask, God, that all we do this morning together as a community would bring a huge smile to your face. And all God's kids said, amen.
Please stand for the call to worship. Family of faith, this must be the place. This is the place for connection and growth, for community and hope. This must be the place for questions like, where are you from and what do you need? For whispers of, I've been thinking of you and I've been meaning to ask. This must be the place because all belong here. All are welcome here. All hurt and joy, needs and prayers, dreams and love are welcome here. So for our call to worship today, we are going to lean into invitation for connection. I want to invite you to take 2 minutes to introduce yourself to someone around you and to share one thing that has brought you deep joy this week, so that we might begin our service with joy, gratitude, and connection. God is near. Let us worship Holy God.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, I think we're going to see, this is what brought me joy this week. I got a keychain. It says PPC on it.
Thank you. To a new song this week. Let's run to the Father, wherever you need to be right now, sitting, standing, jumping. That's where you are welcome to be there.
I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now. I'm lying down. I know that I need you. I run to to grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a context for that kind of love. Grace, I'm done with the hiding, I'm is running from life, from death. I feel this rush deep in my chest. Your mercy is falling out. Just as I am, you pull me in, and I know I need you now.
Run to the Father, to grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again.
I'll run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, again and again and again.
How many of you have ever had a bad day or found someone offering you unsolicited advice? How many of you have ever had a bad week and had someone rush in with dozens of suggestions for how you might fix things, as if you hadn't thought of that before? We have all been there, and we have all done that. It is part of our humanity. Our scripture reminds us today that often in the face of hurt, what people really need is not a list of advice or solutions, but the simple presence of love. So let us pray to God today, acknowledging that we are works in progress and that relationships always come with mistakes and confession. Let us pray. Gracious God, sometimes life feels like cooking with flour. It looks like it should be easy, but we always make a mess. This is particularly true when it comes to our relationships. We so desperately to find the right solution that we overstep the line. Forgive us for assuming the place you fill. Forgive us for imagining that we, in all our humanity, could possibly fix all the hurt in this world. Instead, give us the grace and the strength to stand by our loved ones in their moments of need, to witness their hurt without trying to fix it. You are God, we are not. Teach us how to be a friend. Teach us how to ask, what do you need? Teach us how to point to you. Gratefully we pray. Amen. Let us continue our confession in silent prayer. Family of faith, no matter how many times you have spoken without listening, assumed without knowing, offered without asking, or rushed without waiting, you are forgiven. God knows your desire and your intent. God knows when we try and miss the mark, and God surrounds us in grace. So hear and believe the good news of the gospel. Every day is a new day for love. We are claimed. We are forgiven. We are invited into relationship. Thanks be to God for growth and grace that know no end. Amen. The children are now excused for Sunday school. And we have a community question for all of you as the children are leaving. Ask someone near you or someone new, what's a gift, tangible or intangible, you've received that you will never forget?
Whenever my mask gets stuck on my microphone, I think that just means I'm doing a good job. You know, I think that's what that is. I think a gift that that came to mind that I will never forget is when I think I was probably 7 or 8, and I got a beanbag chair. I was so excited. Gift I'll never forget. I don't know. That's what came to mind. We do have some hardships going on in our congregation today, and I do have some sad news. I'm not sure if you remember the Spraudlin family, but unfortunately, Brooke was found, and she is no longer alive. She passed away just the other day. And we are lifting up the Spraudlin Douglas family. Her husband Andrew was deployed and is actually flying home. I think he's home soon. I never met them personally, but I've heard just beautiful things about their family and about Julie and Jim and AJ and AJ's wife Jamie. And I know they're not worshiping here anymore, but if you know them, they need you. Because that's what we've been talking about the last 7 weeks, is about how we are community for one another. And so I just invite you to reach out to them. She was 30 years old. So giving them as much love and support as we can in this hard time is gonna be important. So I'll be praying for them as well. And as well, I want to mention that Bev Dunlap has gone into hospice care. And so we are going to be lifting her up and her family in prayer today as well. And then also one of our Upper Neo friends, Sean Flanagan, he's their assistant director, is in the hospital and they're running a bunch of tests and we're not sure what's going on. So we have a lot to hold today. And so we are going to lift all of this that has been spoken and unspoken up to God together. And that's what we've been talking about holding and witnessing pain together as a community so that people can move through and heal with it. So let us bring this all to God. God of the here and now, we need you. Oh, how we need you. This world seems to turn upside down all the time. Our center of gravity feels off in moments like these. We are particularly grateful for the care you offer and the stability of our friends, community, and family. So today we say this prayer of thanks for the people in our lives who take the time to ask, what do you need? and gracious God. When we have a hard response, you are there with us. Help us to be there for those that have a hard response right now, Lord. Give us the eyes to see when our neighbors are in need and the wisdom to ask, what do you need? Stop our assumptions cold in their tracks and instead carve out space in us to listen. We are participating and breathing deeply. We are practicing being still. We are practicing opening ourselves up to you. We are practicing listening slowly and intentionally. We are practicing sitting with our pain and honoring it. We are practicing saying what we need and not being afraid to ask for help. And on all this, we need you. Oh, how we need you. The Spradlin family needs you, God. Be with Andrew, Julie, Jim, AJ, and Jamie. Bring that peace that surpasses all understanding. The Dunlap family needs you, God. Be with Bev and her family as she is entering into this time of hospice care. Be with the Flanagan family. They need you. Be with Sean and his family as they are seeking answers and trying to understand what's going on. So gather us in and hold us close. Be with us in our time of waiting, in our praying, in our yelling, in our crying. Be with us in our grief and our sorrow. Be in our relationships, that we might be blessed with friends who support us, and that we might be the friends who can bless others. With deep gratitude and true humility, we pray the words that your Son taught us to pray, saying together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Praise him in the morning for tall and lofty trees, and praise him in the evening for children on their knees. Oh, and praise him in the noonday for gentle birds that sing. Oh, oh, praise him, all ye people, praise the King. And praise him for a peaceful porch and rocking chairs that sway. And praise him for the rolling hills where children laugh and play. Oh, and praise him for the wandering souls that never lost their way. Oh, oh, praise him, all ye people, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. bud that fell and bloomed a rose that day. And praise him that he suffered through the guilt, the grief, the shame. Oh, and praise him that his tender love will still forgive today. Oh, praise him, all ye people, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King. Let it ring, praise the King. Praise the King, praise the King.
Throughout history, people have always been interested to know what a person's last words were. In our passage this morning, we have the last words, at least recorded words, of the Apostle Paul. Some important words to his young friend Timothy. And so we're going to look at 2 Timothy 4, verses 6 through 22. But first, let's pray together. Lord, make the word live to us. Cause us to look past human words to your divine word, so that the words of my mouth and the responses of our hearts and lives might truly be acceptable in your sight. Amen. So listen now to the word of God. Paul writes, "As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. Do your best to come to me soon, for Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he is useful to me in ministry. I have sent Tychicus to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas, also the books, and above all, the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will pay him back for his deeds. You also must beware of him, for he strongly opposed our message. At my first offense, no one came to my support, but all deserted me. May it not be counted against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack and save me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet Prisca and Aquila, the household of Onesiphorus. Erastus remained in Corinth. Trophimus I left ill at Miletus. Do your best to come before winter. Eubulus sends greetings to you, as do Pudens and Linus and Claudia and all the brothers and sisters. The Lord be with your spirit. Grace be with you. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, one of the very special memories of my childhood were visits to my uncle's hardware store in Coronado. It began with the ferry ride over, before the bridge, obviously. I can still remember the creaking sound and the odor of the creosote-soaked pilings at the ferry slip. And then wandering the aisles of the store my grandfather had founded in 1913. Marveling at the huge, or at least it seemed that way to me, four-drawer cash register. Huge by comparison to the little toy one that I had. And then there was lunch at the drugstore fountain counter. Something that I didn't understand in those days was inventory time. It was when he had to take stock of what he had and what he needed. And this was in a day when nails were sold in bulk bins. That wasn't an easy task. Well, it's a good idea to periodically take stock of our lives. What do we have? What do we need? And to formulate some godly goals for the future. Psychologists have discussed and debated and argued about the basic needs of human beings in general. But what about Christians? Well, we can really boil things down to four areas of our life that we need to inventory on a regular basis, to examine how we are doing in order to lead a balanced and complete Christian life. The four areas that are suggested in our scripture lesson this morning are social, physical, mental, and spiritual. Interestingly, in Luke 2:52, the only reference to the life of Jesus between the years of 12 and 30, we find that he was said to have matured in those same four areas. We read Jesus grew in wisdom, that's mental, and stature, that's physical, and in favor with God, that's spiritual, and with other people. That's social. This tells us that these four areas were more than just our human whims or desires. You know, I need a new car, or I need the latest edition of an Apple cell phone. But rather, these are God-given needs to be the whole people that God intended us to be. So let's look at these four areas that are suggested as Paul writes his final letter to Timothy. The first is social. I heard a story of a mother who was visiting her adult son, and she came into his room early one Sunday morning, and the mother said, "Get up, you'll be late for church." The son said, "I'm not going." And there followed a back and forth of, "Yes, you are. No, I'm not. Yes, you are. No, I'm not." Finally, the mother said, "Give me two good reasons why you shouldn't go to church." And the son said, "I don't like the people there, and they don't like me." Mother said, "I still say you should get up and go." The son responded, "No, give me two reasons why I should go to church." And the mother said, "Okay, first of all, you're 40 years old and you're acting like a child. And secondly, you're the pastor." We We all have social needs, no matter who we are, whether we are pastors or whether we are young or old or in between. We have social needs. We want to be liked. We want to be accepted. We want to have a sense of belonging. We need support. We need connectedness. So Paul writes to Timothy in verses 9 through 11, "Do your best to come to me soon, for Demas has deserted me. Get Mark and bring him with you." Can you sense Paul's loneliness, his heartbreak? Not only was he in a literal prison, but also a place of isolation. Demas, his friend, his co-worker, this man who had traveled with Paul, had deserted him. We find Demas mentioned very positively in Colossians and Philemon. He obviously was a committed Christian, but he had fallen to the lure of the world. And that's something that we all need to be on the lookout for, to guard against when the world would pull us away from our Lord and from our Christian friends and commitments. The desertion of Demas hurt Paul deeply, just like it would and does for us. And then on top of that, there was someone we don't know much about, if anything, other than he was a coppersmith by the name of Alexander, and he had caused problems too. But the reverse is true for Mark. On Paul's first missionary journey, you might remember that Mark had gone along, but he couldn't take the rigors of it, so he had left them and gone home. And the next time that Paul set out on a missionary journey, Mark wanted to try again, and Paul said no. But Barnabas, whose name means son of encouragement, said yes. As a result, Paul and Barnabas had quite a disagreement, and they went their separate ways. Well, perhaps it was through the work of Barnabas, something must have happened. And Mark had proved himself to Paul to the point that he wrote, "Get Mark and bring him with you because he is helpful to me in my ministry." He needed companions and co-workers, partners in ministry. Mark and Timothy himself, the recipient of the letter. I've heard it said a number of times by psychologists and psychiatrists that 80% of their work would disappear if everyone had someone that they could really talk to, that would really listen to them, with whom they would feel understood and accepted. We all need that. We need to be that for others. We need to cultivate deep friendships and learn to deepen our communication, not be modern Daniel Boones, who, if he could see the smoke of his neighbor's chimney, decided they were living too close and he needed to move on. Even Jesus had his disciples, and then he had the inner three, James, John, Peter. He had his close friends at Bethany, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. We should look to that and take that as an example. We need others not only for support and fellowship, but we can accomplish so much more that way. That's why God called the church into being and didn't just leave us as individual Christians out there. So we need to take some time to do a social inventory. What do you need, both in terms of giving and receiving? Maybe there's something you need to stop doing in the social realm, like gossip or negative, discouraging speech. Maybe there's something that you need to start doing in the social realm, like showing genuine compassion and concern and care for others. Well, our second area is physical. We all need certain things to support and nurture our physical bodies. The body is the vessel of the Spirit, and we need to take care of it. In verse 13, Paul writes, "When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas." Now, the cloak was a large blanket-like piece of material with a hole in the center that went over the head, much like what we would call a poncho today. Paul had probably been rearrested at Troas and hadn't had time to gather up his belongings. And now winter was coming. That's why he asked Timothy, "Try if you possibly can to get here before winter." You see, even the spiritual giant Paul saw no value in shivering. We are to be concerned with our physical bodies, but in the right way. For some, the body is idolized and pampered at great expense. At the other extreme, some would ignore their body, neglecting it, giving it no concern, almost contempt for it. A life that denies that the body is important is problematic. The body is a machine that is always working, and so it needs care. You know that. And that's why the Bible talks about proper rest, nutrition, not abusing it with chemicals or anything else. Remember what Paul said to the Corinthians in chapter 6. "Do you not know that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body." We are not dichotomous creatures. The state of your body affects the rest of you. I just read again one of the best things to do for common depression. I'm not talking about clinical depression, but common everyday being down is vigorous exercise, because your body affects your whole well-being and ultimately our spirits. That's why we as Christians should be concerned about the physical health and well-being of others as well. Food for the hungry, concern about the spread of illness. It's why Christian missionaries have been sent who shared the gospel of Jesus Christ, but also addressed medical needs and agricultural needs, needs for clean water and so forth. And historically, concern for the sick and establishment of hospitals was largely the result of the spread of Christianity. The first hospital founded in France in AD 651 was called Hôtel Dieu, House of God, because there was that connection. So we are concerned about the physical. Then the third area is mental. Some people's idea of Christianity is a mindless, blind faith. And this seems to be the predominant media and Hollywood view. You know, go to church, put your brain in neutral. Christianity has little to say about our mental and intellectual life. How would Paul respond to that? No way. Even though he knew he was at the very end of his life, bring the books and the parchments. So he wanted the Old Testament. We don't know all what it consisted of. But he wanted, even late in his life, to learn, to study, to grow. And that should be a never-ending process for Christians. 1,500 years after Paul was in prison, another man was in prison by the name of William Tyndale. He was awaiting the death sentence to be carried out. His crime? He had sought to give the people of England the scripture in their own language. Terrible crime. 75% of his work is what we now know as the King James Bible. It was winter. He was in a cold, damp prison in Belgium. He writes to a friend, "Send me, for Jesus' sake, a warmer cap, something to patch my leggings, a woolen shirt, and above all, my Hebrew Bible." He knew that as a Christian, the process of learning and growing is never ending. Presbyterian pastor and author Gary Demarest wrote, "My father-in-law, who was Louis Evans Sr., a veteran pastor and preacher, recently died at age 86. In my study at home, I kept a special section of newly published books that I felt would interest him. The first thing he did on every visit was to greet me with, 'What's new, kid?' I knew Louis Evans, and I can hear him say that. 'What's new, kid?' And then he would head for the shelf. How refreshing it was to bask in the glow of his hunger for learning right up to his final days. Christians I have known throughout my life who have grown and who are growing are inevitably readers, readers of the Bible, readers of Christian books. Listen to Proverbs chapter 2, 3 through 5. If you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasures, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God." The image is that of an ardent treasure seeker, eagerly looking for something of great value. Now, we all like to read things that are entertaining or the latest news, but we need to go beyond that. Marshall McLuhan, Canadian philosopher, especially in the area of media theory, said, "We become what we behold." I think maybe he knew or should have known, the Apostle Paul wrote in Philippians 4:8, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, let your mind dwell on these things." Let your mind dwell on these things. What is your mind dwelling on? That's the mental side of our lives. And what are you going to do to nourish that? And then finally, we come to the spiritual. Now, some people think that 1 through 3 don't really affect the spiritual, but they're wrong. You know, that was the Gnostic heresy of the 1st and 2nd centuries, that you had the spiritual life over here and then the physical and spiritual and social life over here, and what you did over here didn't affect this at all. But that wasn't true, and it isn't true. And Paul knew its importance. In spite of the fact he had been betrayed and deserted, in spite of the physical hardships, he says in verse 17, "But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength." So the last is the most important. Our greatest need is for God. We need God for the same reason that a fish needs water. It's how we were created. As the Apostle Paul said, as recorded in Acts 17:28, "For in God we live and move and have our being." It would be a sad world indeed without God. God gives meaning and purpose to life now and a concrete hope for the future. Many in today's world say, "You know, I really don't need God. I'm doing just great without God in my life." Well, I can tell you, over many, many years of ministry, I have talked to so many people who have borne witness to the fact that they did need God. And they have said things, and I've heard almost the same thing from multiple, multiple people. "If I didn't have God in my life, I don't know what I'd do. I don't know how I could have gotten along." Spanish painter Francisco Goya would often ask people to drop crumbs in a random pattern on a piece of paper. And no matter what pattern it was, he would draw a figure and then a complete drawing from it. Oh, God is like that. He draws all of life together with all of our inconsistencies, our failures, our sins, our disappointments, the good, the bad, the ugly, into a pattern of meeting. God brings all of life together, the social, the physical, the mental, in the spiritual. Because we are spiritual beings created to be in spiritual relationship to our Creator 7 days a week. We need to take stock in the spiritual area. What is the quality of your personal time with the Lord in Bible reading and study and prayer? What is your WQ, not your IQ, but your WQ, your worship quotient? Is worship important to you? Have you learned to worship, whether in church or on your own? In all of the vicissitudes of life, we can echo with certainty what was said by the writer to the Hebrews, 13:5. God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. A small child was once asked, why is there only one God? Their response was, because there is no room for another. God fills every place. And the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, wants to be a part of and fill every area in your life. In the back of the bulletin this morning, there is a question. How can you strive for wholeness in each area, in each of these areas of need in your life? And there are the four areas. I want to give you some homework. Don't groan too loudly. But I want you to take that home and sometime today, tomorrow, but soon, write out, what do I need to do in each of those areas? What kind of godly goals can I set for myself? It's time to take inventory. Are you leading a balanced Christian life? Have you committed all four areas to the Lord? Have you surrendered all to Him? Pray with me, please. Lord, you have made us in your image. As the psalmist said, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. And you have made us complex beings that have needs in various areas, needs to be the complete, full people you have caused us to be. Help us to take seriously the need to examine our lives. Lord, when we reach the end of our days, may we say with Paul, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. We pray this all in the blessed and strong name of our Savior Jesus. Amen.
Please stand if you're able and join us with our closing hymn today, I Surrender All.
To Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender. To Thee my blood. to Jesus I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power, let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all, I surrender.
Thank you, Pastor Bob, and thank you both. We enter this time in a moment of recognizing that we all bring gifts to this place. When we love someone in need, it is easy to give. We show up with casseroles or prayer blankets. We send cards. We make phone calls. We babysit the kids. We drop off flowers. We don't think twice about it because when we love someone in need, it is easy to give. In worship, we give to the offering. What we are also declaring is that not only those we love are worthy of our gifts, but God is worthy of our gifts. And strangers whom we have never met are worthy of our gifts. In worship, when we give the offering, we are declaring that all of creation deserves love and care, which is a radical notion in this hurting world. So today, as a way to practice being in relationship and drawing closer to one another, we invite you to give to the ministry and mission of this church. When we love, it is always easy to give. So you may do so by giving your tithes and offerings. In the back, there is a offering plate there as well. You can give online. There's also other options in your bulletin. So please make sure to take a look there. And don't forget your homework. Am I right? Yeah?
We just sang, I surrender all. I would encourage you, in addition to your homework, to start each day this week by repeating that phrase, I surrender all, and really mean it and see what a difference that makes. Let's sing together the benediction. Pastor Cassie, if you'd lead us.
So, you all have been doing so good with this benediction. The way we do this is I will sing it first, and then we will sing the benediction over one another. And by looking at one another and saying this all and benedicting one another, because we are a community and we do this together. So receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord shine their face upon you and bring you peace. And bring you peace forever. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord shine their face upon you. And bring you peace. And bring you peace forever.
Amen.
Go and serve God.